Hi there, this is Toby Green, and you're listening to The Green Room with Tom Green and Jacob Gaynor. Stay tuned.
Oh, coffee's for a week for that, mate.
What's up, brother?
You might as well do that. What's up, brother?
Special teams.
Hey, how you going?
Good, how are you, Tom?
I'm fantastic, thank you, Jacob. Welcome to all our listeners and our viewers for another episode of In The Green Room. I think this is number 7 now. I think you
number
got it
7.
Wrong last
I
week.
I did get it wrong last week.
Yeah, I thought I'd pull you up on that one. But yeah, it's nice
it's
to be
early.
Back for another episode.
Which, on last week as well, record viewership and downloads or listens.
Really?
Yep. So
there you go. We really are just, we continue to climb.
Well, I wouldn't say it's necessarily our content. It might be Jack Steele.
I suppose engaging another supporter base probably helps us, but that's okay.
But what I will say is that there's probably a lot of St Kilda fans back this week.
I would only assume so after they heard the quality.
But on St Kilda, how was the weekend and in our beautiful hometown of Canberra?
It was amazing. Canberra's always, so good to play in, and we know we get a fantastic turnout from our Canberra crowd there. So that was fantastic to reward them with a win, albeit a little bit of a heart racer at the end, which is quite annoying, but it was a beautiful day in Canberra as well. People like to make a lot about the Canberra weather, but it was absolutely splendid and a nice warm day. And it was nice to come away with the win as well.
Now, there's one thing you wanted me to address on the game. I have the text messages to prove it.
No, you don't.
Surely my goal is getting a run on the podcast this week. It's what the fans want and you know it. So for our producer, Will...
Thanks for...
We'll put the video in now.
No, thanks to our producer, Will, for showing the edited, the doctored screenshots that you've got there, because that didn't happen.
Is that the greatest goal you've ever kicked?
Don't know. There's quite a list to pick from. I don't know if it is. It was a good one, though. It was really weird, though. I didn't need to do it. As in, I didn't... looking back at it, it was really bizarre that I...
That you used the outside of you.
Yeah, as soon as I caught it, I just wanted to check side it, but... And that's all I could think of. But no, I looked at it, I was like, I should have just kicked a drop punt. But
you're all show.
Yeah, finesse shot.
Just a
FIFA mention, which our special guest we're getting on him pretty soon actually backs himself quite heavily at FIFA, and he's quite a handy striker, he likes to think. But I just finesse shot at that one, I think.
You've mentioned our guest early, but what I will say is there's a feature in the green room that we like to – have our guests sit in the room before we welcome them on.
And eyeball them. And have them eyeball us. And he's doing some genuine eyeballing.
And it's up there with one of the biggest guests we've had. Like, we're backing up Jack Steele with a pretty big name.
Yeah, well, this guy is a massive fan of the podcast. He tunes in every single week. And he's been dying to get on. He said he's going to come in pretty hard hitting, and he's got some things to say.
I can confirm when I said, do you want to come on the podcast this week? I got, that was the reaction.
No, he's been excited all day. He's been bouncing around training. He was that pumped. He's been coming over to me beaming with a big smile. Pretty excited for it.
But obviously at the start of the podcast, we've spoken about you and your goal. You wanted that highlighted.
I did.
That's in the podcast. You're welcome. The other thing you wanted to talk about that you're going to take credit for is our beautiful Anzac jumper that we did release this week. Mm. We'll wear it against the Brisbane Lions in our beautiful hometown of Canberra again.
Yep.
Next week. Thoughts on the jumper, and do you want to, I guess we'll talk about it in depth next week, but do you want to talk about how it all came about and what part you had to play in its creation?
Yeah, so this one I actually will take, I mean, I'll only take a little bit of credit for, because the reality is just because of my, I suppose my family connection with Dad being in the army and having that connection, the merchandising team decided to approach me and ask if I wanted to help design I think this was maybe actually 2 years ago or a year and a half ago. And if I wanted to, when I say help design, I wasn't doing any scrawling, any drawings or anything like that. But they just gave me a few options of what we thought would be all right. And this is what I came up with. I just think as much camo as we could get on the jersey was probably going to be the best fit. And I think it's come out all right. I think the general feedback has been pretty good so far, so no, I'm pretty happy with it. It'd be nice. One thing, I mean, the camo is good. I'm glad you can see the camo and the orange as much as you can, because I was worried you wouldn't be able to see that much, but yeah, I think it's a pretty good look. I think, you know, going forward, hopefully we can, I wouldn't mind, see, it may be a bit of a stretch to throw in there, but if you could almost get like an actual, the camo colours, like, and have like a more of a
green.
Yeah, exactly, as in go away like from a Giants orange and whatever, and just get a complete sort of camo inspired jersey. I think that would be cool.
On that, I think that's a great idea, but obviously our brand is orange, but I think it would be a good idea in terms, like, there's no club really with green, is there?
well, Tassie will come in with green, but until then they
We've
don't.
Got 4 years
but
even, to do it.
Yeah, exactly. I've actually just I've come up with my trending topic. Well, sorry, I
if
had
you're
my trending
gonna
topic.
You're going to talk about retro. Is that what you're going to talk about?
No, well, we'll wait and see. But I've got some. I've now got a trending topic that I want to talk about.
Okay.
And that I'm really passionate about.
Are you gonna? Can you give me a hint?
No. No illusions for you, mate. You're gonna get hit by the bus.
I'm excited. All right. So we're gonna introduce our special guest. I'm gonna say my little spiel before he's here, so then he comes in red hot and just ready to go.
Yeah. Which is
because he's
the only
he's
way he knows
right
how.
Behind the camera.
The only way he knows how.
And he can listen to what we're saying. All right. Our next guest may be small, but he's no doubt a big name. He slid to pick 27 in the 2017 draft, and after some well-publicised issues with injury, he has established himself as one of the best small forwards in the competition. Please welcome to In the Green Room, Brent Daniels.
You got us, Binga?
Go, hey.
You got us?
We on?
There we are.
There we are.
Yeah, good.
We're having it.
Welcome.
It's good to be on with a couple of blokes I really struggle to respect. Obviously, we've got our 5'5" cameraman that hides behind the camera all day and pays me out for being small when he's actually, you know, three foot smaller than me. And next to me, I've got my my friend, the dour slow inside mid, that's about 150 of them in the competition, so it's good to be here.
Thanks for coming on the show, Brent fantastic. Daniels. That's all we got time for.
We did suspect Binga might come in pretty hot. It's good to hear Binga. You've stuck true to it. Great to have you on, though, mate.
It's good to be here, mate. Obviously, I haven't watched a clip of this. Don't really care for it, but it's good to be here.
Well,
it's so good to have you.
I'm actually loving the hostile environment. It's funny you say that. A dare inside mid, because I didn't allude to it, but Jacob did before. You got a front row seat to that.
What did you say before we came on? You kick those every week.
Oh, his goal, whatever he calls that. Yeah, no, it was good. It sort of reminded me of my goal in that semi-final against Brizzy. It was sort of a similar goal, so.
He just does it on the big stage, mate.
Yeah, well, I can't really argue with that, because that was a good finish.
That's big stage down in Canberra, so that's good.
Every stage is big for this bloke, mate. Yeah, we're going to be playing some tennis. There's going to be some return serve save, but I'm excited nonetheless. Binga, there's a lot to get through. You've actually got a really interesting story. I know we pay you out, but you do have a really interesting story.
Did it
he's done it tough on life. We'll get to that, because that's a topic.
Yeah, we'll wait. We will get to that one.
But before we start, we're going to obviously address you as Binga. That's what we know you as. Can you explain where that nickname came from?
No, there's no real story to it, actually. It's just sort of always been Binga. And everywhere I go, it sort of follows me. So there's a few spin-offs of it. No, Bingaling.
Kingaling.
Yeah. Kingaling. So it's just followed me everywhere I've gone.
All right, so we'll go back to the start. Tom, you'll cut through with some questions when they pop into your head, but we'll start at the start. Country Victoria boy.
Yeah, born and raised in Swan Hill, which is it's about 3.5 hours from Melbourne, 9 hours from Sydney, and then 5 hours from, well, 5.5 hours from Adelaide, so sort of in the middle of nowhere, but good little town. Love getting back there, and all my friends are there, so it's, love getting there, and it's a good little spot.
And then I guess we'll skip a little part, but when did you first realise that an AFL career was in front of you or a possibility?
Good question. Oh, probably when I was about 6, I reckon. probably.
I've always known.
Probably when I was about 16 or 17. So I made a few reps teams and that along the way, but was never like a standout player, I wouldn't say. Missed a few teams along the way as well, but yeah, I was never really a standout. And then just, you know, being small, it was a bit tough for me, but as Greener likes to take the piss out of me for.
I know exactly what he went through.
But yeah, I was never like a standout player. And then went away to school. And probably when I went away to school, my game probably improved a lot from there. And, you know, I made the Vic Country squad when I was bottom age in my 18th year. But unfortunately hurt my knee. So I, got cut from that pretty quickly. And then just, yeah, my under 18th year, I obviously had a pretty good one and found myself up here.
did say you slid though.
He yeah, reckons the height cost him.
Oh, definitely cost
him. I don't think it's getting drafted out of Victoria, Vic Country, going up.
Oh, I'm sick of hearing this out of Victoria rubbish.
What was it? Geelong Grammar?
Yeah, yeah.
Goes to boards at Geelong Grammar.
What's that got to do with anything?
In the Vic Country pathways, reckons he did it the hard way.
Dude, it's tough, mate. nah, I got drafted in the end and it's a good story, but yeah, I'm here now and as you alluded to before, I've built a pretty good career, so I'm happy with that.
In all seriousness, it's funny, but you may address these games, but pick 27 is a bargain buy. Pick 27 in the second round. And considering we had back-to-back picks, was Brent Daniels into Sam Taylor. I think the Giants recruiting team nailed the second round of the 2017
Caruso trial. Did a good job.
Yeah. Caruso listens religiously to this podcast, so shout out to you, Adrian.
He's done a good job.
But on the draft, did you know you were coming to the Giants? What other clubs were interested? And how did you feel about, I guess obviously you were going to have to leave country Victoria, but how did you feel about leaving Victoria?
I didn't really know where I was going to go or when I was going to go. Obviously, I knew I was going to go somewhere. I think the Giants, Carlton and Melbourne had back-to-back picks and I'm pretty sure they were all going to take me with their next pick. So the Giants got pretty lucky there with that one. as I said, I went to boarding school, so that prepped me pretty well to come up here. And as you said, I'm a country boy, so even if I was in Melbourne, I wouldn't really be living at home. So, Sydney's only an extra hour flight in the end and you still got to drive 3.5 hours to get home. So, I ended up in a pretty good spot. And luckily enough, actually, at the time, the Giants didn't have that many small forwards. So I probably was getting games when I probably wasn't up to it. And, it's probably held me in good stead now that I got some games under my belt when I was nowhere near the level.
How did your family feel about you moving to Sydney?
Oh, I think just mum was obviously not upset, but
far away from home.
Yeah, he's he's going a long way away. But Dad was pretty wrapped. Obviously, he's a big footy head himself, so he was pretty happy just to see me get my opportunity at the level. And, I've got two brothers, Corey and Riley. They were obviously stoked for me as well, and they're doing their own thing. So, it's good.
They're a good family, the Daniels. I imagine your old man would have been pretty matter-of-fact. And
he's a straight shooter. I don't think he's ever said well done to me.
Much like yourself, though, I was going to say it's funny you talk about the start of your career. I think you're selling yourself a little bit short about, just for our viewers at home and our listeners, Binger is without a doubt his own harshest critic. And I think sometimes, and it's in all facets, I've told him I reckon he's too harsh on himself on occasion. So it's just funny it's funny to hear him say that about the start of his career because, I mean, the Giants were a good side. I don't think you were necessarily getting games and not doing much. As you said, you were kicking game winners in finals. So
yeah, that was class. No, but back to my old man. Yeah. Just to paint a picture of what he's like. It was a St Kilda. In the final last year, we beat St Kilda pretty easily. Did it well. Get in the rooms. Everyone's up and about. Mum's hugging me, kissing me, whatever. And my old man is sitting in the corner, not smiling. He's like, geez, you blokes will have to play a bit better next week to win. And I've said to him, mate, if you're going to be like that, you can get out. You're an idiot. I was actually so pissed off. I was like, mate, just put a smile on your face and sit down and shut up.
As I said, they're a good quality family.
That's probably where I'll get a little bit from.
Your brothers are great fun too, right?
Oh, Riley,
you've got some good stories. I think was that after the Carlton game or?
Yeah, after the Carlton game.
Last year
when we obviously won and secured a final spot. Yeah, he just made an absolute dick of himself.
No, he didn't. He was in good form.
He did, mate.
I hope Riley listens. He should listen.
He'll listen to this one.
He was in very good form. He's hilarious. Like I said, all the Daniels, they're a great family and very funny. And your brothers, particularly
he has three beers and puts the googly eyes on. genuinely, it's embarrassing. Nah, he's a good. He's a good man, though.
You mentioned coming in and almost not being gifted games, but you played pretty early into your journey at the Giants, but when did you really feel established? Was it that second year?
Probably back end of my second year, I reckon. Leon Cameron, obviously, who was our coach. There was one week where I was on the cusp of getting dropped and I think it was between like myself, Daniel Lloyd and Zach Langdon, who used to play here. And yeah, I ended up getting a nod. And from there, I was like, oh, he obviously believes me and thinks I'm good enough to play. And I think from my back end of that year was like really strong, like compared to what I'd been doing. So from there, I think I, you know, just continued to improve, and belief and confidence grew from that.
What's it like as a kid playing in a side that was relatively successful during that time as well, and then obviously playing in the grand final?
Yeah, no, it's obviously like when you came to the club, I'm like, geez, like it's a really good team. Like I didn't, to be honest, I didn't really know many of the players, like because as we know, like Giants never really play on prime time. So yeah. Like if I'm at school, the only games I get to watch is Channel 7, and the Giants rarely played. So I didn't know a heap of the players, but when I got here, I was like, geez, there's some really good players here. And, you know, just being a competitor and someone that wants to win, you're like, geez, I'd love to be a part of that side. And luckily, I got a good chance in that second year. And as you mentioned, got to play in the grand final, which was really cool. And probably didn't really, like, understand. Because it was in such a good team, I was like, yeah, this is just going to happen every year. Like, I was like, took it for granted a little bit. So pretty keen to try and get back there. And I'll lap it up a bit more, I think.
When does that thought come through? Like, when is it during, obviously we'll get to it in parts, but injury troubles, is that when you kind of reflect and go, wow, it is tough to get there? Or is it in like 2020, and I think it was 2020 when the club didn't have the greatest year following the grand final, when you're like, wow, like it's tough?
Yeah, probably that 2020 year, really. Like, our team didn't really change. I think it might have been your first year, was it?
Yeah, it was my first year.
So, like, our team was pretty much similar. I know it was COVID, so it's a little bit different, but yeah, we had the same team and pretty much didn't make finals. I was like, geez, it might be a little bit harder to get back there. So, yeah, you just definitely got to relish the good times.
And I guess how quickly did it go from, you've obviously gone from the highs of being in a successful side, you're playing really, really good footy, you're playing in a grand final, to, like, when did your first, like, major injury come about?
Yeah, so I never had any, like, soft tissue stuff at all, even as a kid. Like, never really had any injuries, really. So my first hammy was in 2021 at the start of it, like right at the start, did a little one, and then obviously came back from that, and then did the exact same thing playing Adelaide, so hurt the exact same spot in my tendon, and then got back from that again, and then did the same thing on the other leg against Geelong in Geelong, and that was pretty much my season done. So it sort of started there, and a few things sort of rippled from that, I guess you'd say.
And when did you go to the US?
I went to the US at the end of 2022, so...
Missed the entire 2022.
Yeah, so I obviously, Connor Iden, my good friend, had a...
Avid listener too.
He pretty much shattered my foot in a bit of a... it wasn't his fault, it was just a footy incident, but yeah, landed on my foot a bit funny and obviously ruptured my Lisfranc joint, which is a really important part of the body. And I think I broke like four bones as well. So that was probably like in that year, to be honest, everything probably rippled off that because like my foot was so sore when I was coming back to play. And then just obviously I just wasn't conditioned and I hurt my hammy doing this like test in the gym.
I was going to bring that up, test.
Like everywhere I've been is like... Have you heard of someone doing this? And like, no, that should be impossible to do. Yeah. So like, I don't know how it happened, but yeah. So I hurt my tendon in my hammy there doing that. Then, you know, 4 weeks later, I stuffed up. I was doing flies out there and I was racing and I was just being an idiot and hurt my tendon again.
Is that more like frustration? Are you just trying to get back?
No, I was just like, not frustration. I was just like naive and.
Thought you were ahead of anywhere.
Thought I was going better than what I was. Not like me to be like that. But, and yeah, hurt my tendon again. And then the club just sort of said, look, just we're going pretty average. Just pack it up for the season. And yeah, enjoyed my off season and obviously went over to the States. And
just before a little player driven leadership conference in Austin.
Yeah, Austin City Limits, player driven leadership conference. So it was good. Sort of changed the club around a fair bit. But yeah, it was obviously a pretty average period of my life. As bad as like, obviously there's big things going on in the world, but when you're a footballer and you can't do what you love, it is really big. But thankfully, I've learned some lessons, and I'm definitely not, you know, through it all. I don't think the reality is I'm probably going to do another hammy in my life. Like that's just how my body's built. But you know, if I can make sure I don't continue to have big ones and keep them in check. You know, that's the main idea.
Might be a little bit of a personal question, but how do you go about, like, if you're saying it's inevitable that you're going to get injured again, and you've obviously got what we hope is a long career still ahead of you, but what are your coping mechanisms, or like what if you did a hamstring, like what do you go back to?
Yeah, good question. I just think, like, I think when you do it, like, you learn that there's so much more to, like, life than just football. Like, I guess, like, a four-week hammy, what's that? Like, yeah, it's frustrating, but at the end of the day, like, you're going to get back. Like, it's not like you're going to, yeah. So I guess I'll just go back to that.
It's a great mindset. But how would you – you're obviously a very well-publicised return last year in round one, and you did it alongside Jack Buckley, who had missed a similar amount of time to you. And I think it was 590 days you had between games. And I remember interviewing you after the game, and it was a pretty dramatic win in, like, 40-degree heat against the Crows. It was an insane game. And I remember interviewing Bucks first and then yourself, and you both got really, really emotional, but both mentioned each other and how hard it had been. What's it like as, like, obviously you're a popular figure around the club and you're quite close with a fair bit of the playing group, but what's it like being isolated for that long?
Yeah, I reckon that's probably the main thing. Like, you just feel so, like, disconnected from the group. Like, I guess, the best thing about being at the Giants, I reckon, is, like, we travel so much and, like,
you
just, like, get so close with the teammates and you spend, like, I don't know, I reckon we spend so much more time than any other club. I don't know if you would agree.
No, definitely. But, definitely recommend it.
Yeah, I think that's...
You almost have to, because you don't go back to your family, you go hang out with your mates.
Mm. Yeah, so...
Because we move from elsewhere, like, we don't have mates really outside the club necessarily, they're here, so, or we have.
Yeah, so I just think it's more that, like, the disconnection from the club, like, the amount of times, like, on a Saturday morning, like, myself and Bucks would be here, it could be, like, pissing down rain outside and we've got to get out there and slog away knowing that we're not going to play this year. Like, you know what I mean? So... That's probably the main thing is, you know, you don't feel overly a part of the club, which sounds a bit shit because you are, like, that's the reality. But, and the club was going shit too. Like, we were horrible that year, you know, like, a lot of our mates were getting, like, smacked in team meetings. Like, it was hard to watch at times. And knowing you couldn't help them out was probably a tough one as well.
Yeah, it was tough. Well, I mean, yeah.
What's it like from your side of things? Like, you're saying, mate...
Yeah, well,
away
I was going to say, really I've been, touch wood, I've been very lucky. I've had never really had, like, the most serious injury I've had is I broke my arm, but I did it at the end of the year. So, like, it doesn't really count. But watching those guys miss, as Binga said, like, there is stuff going on in the world, but watching someone not be able to do what they absolutely love is, like, it's tough, like, watching from a teammate. And I'm not going to pretend to know, like, what it's like to be, miss a whole year and be rehabbing a whole year because... Like, I don't know what that experience is like, but no doubt it sucks. And watching them, like, watching both Bucks and Binga, who are two of my best mates, go through that is, like, it's tough because you also, like, I try and feel, I remember, like, I can laugh at it now, but there was one time, like, Binga, when he's in the middle of all this,
is this a beard?
Yeah. He just, this, like, is a good one. Like, I just saw him in the change rooms after, like, yeah, the week, whatever, and he let his beard grow. Because Binga actually grows quite a good beard. I wish I could grow a beard like he, but he grows quite a thick beard. And
the hair was long.
Yeah, his hair had gone a bit long. He had a haircut for a while. And, like, reflecting on it, he obviously, like, he's down in the dumps. And so he's, like, let his beard grow out a little bit. And I was like, I actually thought he was looking good, though. I thought, like, the hair's a bit longer. The beard's a bit bigger. And I was like, Bing, like, you're looking good. Like, you've let the hair grow out. Like, you're looking a bit, he's like, why do you say that to me? I'm clearly feeling shit.
I'm looking shit. I'm feeling shit, mate. You're lying to me.
Yeah, why are you lying to me for? And I was like, what do you mean? But, like, it's a reflection of, it's hard to connect. As you said, when they're not in with the playing group the whole time, you don't get to connect with them as much. And you don't always know, like I said, when they go home and they're upset because they're not doing what they love and things aren't going their way, you feel sometimes a little bit helpless because you want to be there for them. And you try to be as much as you can, but, you know, you can't relate fully and it's hard. Like, it's hard for them, no doubt, as Binga said, and it's hard to watch your mates go through that too.
Yeah, well, we'll switch it up, but thank you for answering
that.
Let's
lighten the mood up. Yeah. Jeez.
But I do appreciate you answering and those questions, like, pretty rawly, to be honest.
Yeah,
I'm sure that the fans of In the Green Room will appreciate it. But let's talk about away from the football club. You currently live with Harry Perriman and Giants netballer Jamie Lee Price.
Yep.
Can you tell us a little bit about that situation? What's it like living with those two?
Yeah, I've been given my marching orders So no,
hey, you're out.
Yeah, I'm out. So they've
was that
they've
a Jamie or a Harry decision?
I'm not sure. I think it was a bit of both. Obviously, they've been together for a while now, so they just sort of said they want their own space. So they've given me the ass.
Time to ship off.
How many weeks notice?
Nah, they told me. They told me in January, and they just said, "Look, like we want to live probably by ourselves, so no rush." But pretty much we don't like you anymore. So I found a little apartment in Bronte, so I'll start moving into that in the next couple of weeks, which will be a good change up. I've been living in Des Moines, so it's a bit of a change up, which will be good. A bit closer to my mate Greener.
I was about to say I've got conflicting feelings about it though, because as good as it'll be to have Binga within walking distance, and the apartment that he's moving into quite literally is walking distance from mine, which is going to be amazing. Anytime there are tough times for us, we'll be able to wander up, have a couple of pizzas.
Box and a pizza, a couple of red wines maybe.
So maybe just some pizzas.
A box or two.
But he's also, Binga used to be a big one for, he'd be ripping into the boys that had moved east and think they're above themselves, and they've gone over, they're getting carried away, getting stuck in the bubble, and now Binga's followed suit. He's trying to form the blue zone in Bronte.
I'll put my hand up, yes. But to be honest though, to be fair, like you blokes get ahead of yourselves. I'm coming over to be that calming influence on you guys.
You look at the people that live over there, myself, Rika, Seeker, or Connor Iden, Zave O'Halloran, Jack Buckley, like recently Josh Kelly, Toby Green. These aren't blokes that get carried away.
Are we talking about yourself? Because you get carried away.
I just enjoy the East for what it is, the close to the beach lifestyle.
It'll be a good change up, and I'll put my hand up. I did make some comments that make me look like a bit of a hypocrite.
But it's good to have Binga. It's good he's owned them, and it's good to have him within walking distance.
Wait, so you're living alone?
Living alone, yeah.
Dog Max going with you?
Nah, my dog's not here at the moment. He's back at home with mum and dad. Just makes it a bit easier to find a place.
Oh, absolutely.
No one likes dogs in Sydney, apparently. So
yeah, it's a shame. Poor Max. He's a good little dog, Maxie.
Mate, don't lie to me. You pay him out all the time.
You would have seen it on Binga.
I was going to say, if you follow Brent Daniels,
mate, it would have been 6 months since I've put him on my story.
No, that's such a lie.
No, it's not. And I'll tell you one bloke I'm going to go at. It's Briggs. He doesn't even own a dog and he puts him on his story.
If
I'm talking to you, Briggsy.
Yeah, that's...
He watches too.
And he's turned into an influencer.
Hey, he's just going your tactic. No, sometimes you put the dog in your story, you get a couple of reactions.
Exactly.
That's what he's fishing.
Yeah.
No.
Little Maxie on the story looking all cute, perched up.
Little 7:30. No, he's not here at the moment, so.
It's a shame.
How are you going to go cooking by yourself? Because I've heard you're an Uber Eats man.
No, I'm great cook.
Ooh.
What's your go-to?
Specialty?
Whatever you want. No, like just steak
that
and
sounds like
steak
a housewarming
and
dinner invite.
Mm.
Steak and veg.
Oh, gains you.
The friendship's not that tight.
I don't know you. Remember I dropped that one on King It's?
Yeah. What'd you say to him?
No, I had a birthday dinner and he said, thanks for the invite. And I said, mate, we're not that close. And this was like in his first couple of months.
Was he rattled?
No, brought the house down. Yeah, that's great. But that's similar
to
you.
You're a comedian, aren't you, mate?
Yeah, he finds comedian. Himself funny.
Similar to you, Gaines. We're not that close, mate. So.
No, it's great to have you here, man. Appreciate it. Can't wait to get you back. All right, we're gonna move on to Tom's trending topic. You're welcome to stay if you want, Binga.
Yeah, I'll stay. I want to hear this clown go about his business.
All right, here we go.
Ranger.
All right, trending topic, Tom. What do you got?
Okay. All right, I've got to lock in here. All right. My trending topic is going back to our jersey a little bit. Okay. So I get that we are the orange team. Mm-hmm. I understand that that's now what we've been dubbed incorrectly at the time, but we are now the orange team and we're leading into the orange. I really want us to bin it off. And I want us to bin it off for a couple of reasons. Because, for instance, it frees up things like if we wanted to go the full camo jersey on Anzac Day. It's great. If we want to wear our Never Surrender jersey more often, which is the best jersey in the entire competition.
Facts.
We can do it more often if we go away from this orange team thing. And I understand that a lot of our merchandise and administration and everything loves to lean into the orange part of it. But it frees up so much for us, and people love our Never Surrender jersey. We need to get that out there more often. Also, a retro round, our old blue Team GWS jersey. I think they played in the Tap Cup. That would be unbelievable for us to wear in a game. People would love it. It looks good too. We just don't need to go orange as much as we do. I think we need to lean into the charcoal part of us, or just we're the Giants. We're not the orange team. We're the Giants. Our jersey can be the charcoal Never Surrender jersey, and it frees us up for a Team GWS jersey here and there. More alterations with others. I just think we need to lean into it more, and it really annoys me that we don't. That is what I want to get on the agenda. I want fans to push for that, because if the fans push for it, it's going to put pressure on our front office, which I'm happy to do.
Every year I've been at this football club, we've got a photo of Toby wearing the Team GWS jumper, and he goes nuts. Like, it would fly off the shelves.
Yeah, it'd be massive. And so that's why I want us to go away from the orange team, lean into being the Giants, and so that we can do more with our jerseys, do different things with our jerseys. And because we have some of the best jerseys in the competition, it means freezes up and means we can get on it more. And so I want our fans, which is so many in the green room listeners and viewers, to put pressure on the Giants socials and on the administration to make sure that we can get this changed.
Get a hashtag on.
Yeah, I don't know what that hashtag is, but we'll sort it out. That's my trending topic, and I want it to happen soon. Certainly, while Binga and I are still at the club, so that we can be rocking it more often.
Any comments?
It looks
Binga?
Good on it. Being orange doesn't look good on you and
My argument would be: is the charcoal kit great because we only wear it a couple of times? So it's like they've got it on.
Yes,
I know what you mean. No, but it's not good because we wear it limited times.
If you wear it every week, it's like, geez, they went, like, you know what I mean?
It still look good.
It's old quick. We're wearing this Guernsey. It's a big game.
It doesn't get old quick though. The other thing is, like, for instance, the Blues jersey, it's tougher to wear these jerseys and our other jerseys with other stuff. So like wear to the footy, like it doesn't look that great, right? Carlton's
not a fashion parade, mate.
No, but it is.
Can wear whatever, like the fans don't have to wear the right jumper every week.
It just looks, the charcoal jersey looks cool. You can wear it in more environments. We need to lean into it.
You'll be the sheaf in it then.
I don't go to the sheaf, mate.
I've seen you there recently too.
I'm Ravisi's on Bondi Beach. Classy.
You're a hero.
I agree with Binga. I don't think you make the Never Surrender jumper. Has to be a part-time jumper, otherwise it loses its touch.
It doesn't. I do agree that it could open up other avenues, but the charcoal needs to be for the derbies.
Yep,
I agree.
Charcoal for the jumper.
We need to rebrand the gather round.
You wear the Team GWS one.
And I don't know. I'm just saying we need to lean into being the Giants more so that we can get rid of the orange more. Because
you want us to have a Canberra kit with your face on it?
I do not want that at all. With my complexion, orange is not good.
That's selfish.
It's not selfish. Mate. That looks good on a few people. The charcoal looks good on everyone. That is the truth. Facts. Anyway, it's my trending topic. I don't care if you do disagree. Next segment.
All right.
I know the fans back it.
Whatever. Right, we're moving on to a new segment that you want to introduce, right?
Oh, yes.
Yep.
I do.
Got that?
Yep, all right. Gotcha.
Here we go. Tom, take it away. What is the new segment?
Yeah, so I thought I'd, as this podcast is, the light of my week, the light of my life, even you could say. I think about it quite a lot, and I thought there was a new segment that I wanted to add, and that's just Song of the Week, or it could be Album of the Week, but I want to add some music in. Music's a big part of my life, as it's a big part of a lot of people's. And so I thought that was something that we could bring on with our special guest each week as well. They can just bring on and suggest a song to our viewers that they think they'll find interesting, or what they're just listening to at the minute, what they're vibing with. So people at home can get put on and, I suppose, hear what we're enjoying. So I'll start off. Or would you like to start off, Jacob?
You start.
Well, I'll start off with my song for this week. It's going to be it's a new song, actually. This album came out last Friday. So it's for those rap fans out there. I will say I listen to a lot of rap. That's generally what I listen to and what I enjoy the most. And if you're familiar with rap at the minute, you'd know Future and Metro Boomin have dropped a couple of albums recently. They dropped We Don't Trust You, and then they just last Friday dropped We Still Don't Trust You. So there's a little follow-up there, a little collab album between those two. And my favourite song at the minute is Drink and Dance. It's a great vibe. I'm enjoying it a lot. It's a little bit of – the first album was a lot more sort of harder rap. This one's got a few more vibes, a little bit more relaxed, some nicer tunes. And Drink and Dance I'm liking a lot. Yeah, I don't know if producer.
What's the perfect setting to listen to that?
Well, I think the reason that I like this one a bit more is that Drink and Dance, I mean, you could listen to, my ideal one would probably like a late night drive. You know, when you're cruising late at night, like late night drives, it's a great song for that.
You know where that's really good? Canberra.
That is pretty good there because there's no
stop. Not much else. You have to stop.
Yeah, exactly. But no, late night drives, it's really good for, but it's also, it's good enough, like it's versatile enough. You could play it, you know, if you're just chilling around, having a few
pre-game,
few drinks. Boxes. Yeah, exactly. Pre-game would also be good. I played it in the gym today. It's versatile. It's a very good song.
Binga?
Yeah.
Probably I'm not, first question, what's your music taste like? Like, are you a rap man?
I'm more of like pop, a country popular, like Taylor Swift, like Zach Bryan, whatever's same, going at the time.
104.7.
Yeah, one thing I will say, though, and I don't know if you need to give us a rendition, but Binga's a very good singer. Him and Connor Iden rate themselves as singers, and they are actually both quite good. Binga's particularly...
You did see it on Binga's birthday?
Husky. Yeah, he's got a good husk in his voice. Yeah.
So I'm liking Burn, Burn, Burn at the moment by Zach Bryan. It's
good. Yeah, okay.
Zach Bryan's just a talent.
It's a good one.
Yeah.
He's a talented man.
Yeah, pretty sure that's what it's called. I'm not overly sure.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm not a big Zach
You're
Bryan
a big
fan
like singer in the car? Like concert featuring Brent Daniels?
Yeah, the a little bit. I think everyone is, aren't they? Sure.
Yeah, the concert we get is in the rooms. Bing is like in the locker room.
Yeah, I do think I'm okay.
Well, I've read that you... When you were, or still currently, but when you were living with Harry Perriman, you came into the club separately so you could listen to your own thing.
Yeah, probably. And like the driving thing is more around so I can just call whoever I want when I'm...
Have your own space.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's not the segment, is it? yeah, but if I'm going to do a rendition, I need my mate Iden with me. Yeah. So.
We'll sort that out for one time. Yeah. I'm sure that the
you know
in the green room
listeners and viewers, you're not going to like this idea. I think we get Binga and Seek to do a In the Green Room song.
I would
like a
mind
theme
that.
Song.
Oh.
That would be pretty classy. Like, that would be if you guys cool. came up with one, we could play that instead of Tubbs' intro.
Yeah. We sack
we
Toby.
We could do that. What's Tubbs' nice. Intro?
Ready? I'll play it.
Hi there. This is Toby Green, and you're listening to The Green Room with Tom Green and Jacob Gaynor. Stay tuned.
Yeah, it's average.
Oh, coffee's for a week for that,
mate. Yeah. It's dour.
Yeah, we'll make a song.
Yeah, I think you might have to.
You know, all right. Well, that's actually really exciting.
Yeah, that is exciting.
I don't know if he'll be on board, though.
He'll be on board.
We'll wait and see. We won't commit to anything fully yet, but that could be in the works. Gaines, yourself.
I'm very similar to Binga. Like, I love current pop music, anything country. Basic, easy to listen to music. I don't like, not a massive rap fan.
No rap for me.
Like there might be a couple of good songs here and there, but nothing special. But this is my song this week. You may have already heard it when we introduced Binga.
Who's that by?
American Authors. And I actually have a thing at the moment. I'm a big fan of old FIFA songs.
Yeah, okay.
So if you're wondering where that's from, FIFA.
I agree. Is that what FIFA edition?
Don't know.
It's now EA Sports, of course.
EAFC.
It's not FIFA.
Come on, mate. You just said at the top of the podcast you were good at it. Obviously, you don't even
I didn't say I was good at it.
Yes, you did. You said Binga is.
No, I said I didn't. I said Binga is very handy at it. As I said, a bit of a fox in the box.
Class.
Anything else you wanted to add to that segment, or is that just us naming?
No, songs? I think like that's all it has to be. Is we just recommend a song to people. It doesn't have to be as long winded. Or I know my loquacious nature has drawn the segment out a little bit, but I think it's just a little one where we can put forward to the fans and put them on, see if they want to tune in, and give us any feedback on it.
Do we take fan songs?
No. They're clowns. I don't want to hear it.
Ooh.
I'm
and
kidding.
We just lost half our viewership.
I'm allowed a joke. Okay. We're all mates here.
Yeah, in the green room.
Are we?
Oh, Binga said we're not mates.
I didn't say that, mate.
You looked at me and said we're not mates.
I didn't say that. You're putting words in my mouth.
Yeah. All right, we're going to get to the final part, and that's the poem. Get excited. I said the poem, but I've missed a crucial segment, and if we don't do it, I won't stop hearing about it for a 7-day period. Tom, ASMR.
This is only going to be very brief. This Thank one, you. I want to do, next one I've got a really good one. I need to make sure I sort it out, but this is my one for this
you lack
week.
A lot of preparation.
That's not true at all. This is this week's ASMR. I'll keep it brief. We'll see if people enjoy it. It's just going to be a pen running over the microphone. We'll see if that sounds any good.
What's this?
ASMR, you'll see. It's like you know when people eat stuff on like Like there's those videos of them eating stuff up close and you can hear
You know that thing that was cool 5 years ago? Yeah. Tom, bring it back.
Anyway, so we'll wait and see if this sounds good. If this tickles anyone's fancy, we'll wait and see. You can let me know, Bing. I'm sure you will, no doubt.
All right, that was a good... That was good.
Don't you think that'll just run up and down someone's spine? Like, I think they just will.
I doubt it.
I agree.
Anyway, that's what this week's segment of ASMR. Let's move on to the poem so I can roast it.
All right, Binga, do you know what this segment is?
No.
All right, so weekly, I do a poem. It's simply just...
Oh, yeah, I have had a listen, yeah.
You're average.
I think.
All right, ready? I might actually put this here so I can face the both of you.
So you want to get into Binga as well?
Oh, I'm going hard at Binga.
Yeah. So you get to rate his poem then
you
as
don't
well.
Think, we you both think, get to rate You it. Think he can just walk on, call me small and get away with it?
I just spit facts, mate.
Like. Yeah, and I'm coming back with some facts. All right.
Let's hear.
Tom and Binga, it's been a pleasure, but you've had your turn to speak. Now it's my turn. Let's recap the week. What a weekend it was in the beautiful Canberra. Monica's now a fortress. It's a brand new era. It was a close finish, but the Giants got the dub. Tom also founded his own fan club. Tom wants to make one thing absolutely clear. His check side is without doubt the goal of the year. He wanted me to bring it up. He didn't want to gloat. He also told me to encourage you to vote. No doubt, Tom, that was a goal from the top shelf. I'm not surprised you voted for yourself. In all fairness, I watched the goal and thought, wow, but you're still no good. Not as good as Matt Rau. The perfect weekend. I had no complaints. I'll leave that for the team over at the Saints. Cogs got hurt when his knee got stuck. He was cleared of a serious injury. Thank. Taylor has also been cleared. That's good news. Lucky for Harry and Charlie. He'll miss our clash with the Blues. If we're the real deal, next weekend will be the proof. We meet Voss and his crew under the roof. Thank you to our guest, Brent. He was great, and I think you'd all agree. He's the only guest so far that's been smaller than me. All three of us are single. That's nothing but facts. If only we could post thirst traps of Max. He's one of the best in the game, the boy from Country Vic. He loves a goal, and my God, he's quick. Seriously, though, he's rapid. Most defenders are screwed. The only thing faster than that is when he changes his mood. That's it for the poem. I bet you're all glad. Only ending it now, because Binga looks mad. You've been a great guest. You're up there with Seek. Good luck against the Blues, and I'll see you boys next week.
Well done, Jacob.
No applause there from Daniels.
Nah, no applause from me, man.
And then you give it a rating out of 10.
A rating out of 10?
10 out of 10.
Oh, yeah, nice, mate. It was a good rhyme. lacked vocabulary, I thought. And you lied.
Yeah.
You lied to the listeners.
So this is this is one thing.
When you said I'm smaller than you.
Yeah, that's one thing.
It's a blatant lie, so for that, 5 out of 10.
Nah, nice. So one
I'm not taking your rating.
Right. My issue that I've always had with yours is factual.
Have you mentioned facts?
Yes, I have. I've said that.
You have not.
I've critiqued your delivery before, but I think accuracy is an important point, which Binga has pointed out. And if you're spreading inaccurate things, well, then that's not something we can really accept or handle.
It's dirty.
Look, not bad. I didn't mind you going at Binga. As you know, I love it when you go at me. I think that's always good fun. Some of it, again, there was some incorrect stuff about me, which...
Care to address what I lied about?
Yeah, I just that sort of that stuff about bringing up my goal and that I wanted that talked about. So I didn't really need to hear that.
Text messages to prove it.
So I'm going to give you 7.5. It's okay. It's pretty good.
It's generous.
Yeah, but it's nothing standout.
Yeah, great.
I can't wait for the one that blows my socks off.
That I actually thought that was going to be it. I was actually really happy with that one.
It shows you I need a lift.
Okay. Anything else to add, Binga?
No, it's been good, boys.
Have you enjoyed it, Bing?
Yeah, it's been a good
got a bit off your chest?
Change of scenery. No, it's been good. Obviously, I might listen to this one.
You should.
So,
review
like the sound of your own voice.
This guy does. So, that's why he's got a podcast, obviously.
Oh, come on. I got bailed up by Gaines.
Hey, you're welcome.
No, it's been good.
No problem.
Enjoyed my time.
Thank you for having. Thank you for coming on.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for coming on, Bing. Mate, we're waiting on you and Seek to...
Yeah, I'm excited for this theme song.
To get that song
going
for
us. Yeah, it might be tough. We're not really musically gifted.
We'll wait and see. Anyway, thank you to all in the green room listeners. Thank you for tuning into another episode. As I said, we're on YouTube, as you all know. You can watch our beautiful faces yap for 45 minutes, or you can just tune in on all major streaming services. Thank you very much, and we'll see you next week.